We're excited about this afternoon. We have an all-star panel for you of boots on the ground all over the world doing amazing work, things that you guys are interested in. Many of you in the room, I know, you have the same purpose and life calling and desire to be engaged all over the world in ways that we can affect justice and do that in a way that isn't creating harm. And so we're delighted that you're here. I think you're going to be amazed by this panel. They're going to share a little bit for a few minutes in each of their nonprofit work, and then we'll give an opportunity for you to ask a few questions. We have four different speakers happening in this particular session, and then we'll take a break, and then we'll have three speakers in our afternoon session after the break. So if you have questions as they're talking, be sure to write those down, and we'll give you an opportunity to interact with our group and have an opportunity to discuss some of the things that they're learning and doing around the world. To start off, Kim Biddle is here. She's the founder and director of Saving Innocence. She's working with child trafficking, human trafficking, rescuing kids from that around the world, and particularly in LA. She's considered an expert in the field. She's appeared on television shows in that capacity. She's right here local. I know we've shown a video of Kim speaking with her heart about what she's doing here recently with our students, and now we have her here in person for you to have a chance to interact with. She got her BS and her MSW at USC, so she is a local girl, loves LA, and has a real heart for this city and is doing amazing work. Would you please join me in welcoming Kim Biddle?
Hello. Are you guys like exhausted at this point? I'm sure you've been just water hosed with information up to this moment. So thank you for taking the time and for caring about this issue and just hearing a little bit about what we're doing here in LA. I have way too much information to share with you, so I'm just going to like crank through and hope that there's a little bit of time at the end for question and answer. So just to give you like a little backdrop, just so that you have a context of understanding that like all the speakers today were just normal people that at some point decided to step out of our comfort zone and seek to learn how to do justice in this world. Growing up, Orange County in LA, normal kid, other than the fact that I had a lot of history of sexual abuse and neglect growing up. And because of that in my life, that really fueled a need to want to help prevent that for other people, as well as to bring restoration for other people. That kind of came to a head when I was 18, early college, became highly suicidal, and it was in that moment that I heard God start speaking to me that I was worth more than what had happened to me. I was worth more than my circumstances, and that there was another way out. And so after becoming Christian and dedicating my life to Him, He began to heal me and turn all the things that had been used to destroy my life into helping set others free and to be tools to bring healing for other people. So it's just interesting to see how, you know, I think people on stage, like, they can come across as being perfect or like, you know, perception of having everything put together. And so just give like the background of totally not true then or now. And so that's just to set the stage of what was next. So after being relieved of that, my career first led me to what I thought was the furthest out people in the world. And to me, that was in third world countries. It was in Southeast Asia and 10 countries in Africa. And I just fell in love with the poor and fell in love with those who I thought were too far gone, because that's how I felt growing up. Through that work, I was exposed to a lot of injustices, one of which was human trafficking. And to be seeing firsthand these children being taken out of brothels and put into these foster homes, and these white men from around the world lining up outside to select their product, like these children were cattle for sale, was just, at the very least, say, life-changing. It, you know, as I say, gloriously ruined my life and sent me on this trajectory of doing something about that. It was so overwhelming, it was so multi-layered that I knew I needed to start seeking out how to resolve that. Shockingly, there are, some say even more than this, I've heard other stats say 32 million, but at least 29 million slaves around the world, more than ever before in human history. One of our first clients was a young girl named Kayla. Kayla, like many of the girls that we work with, was set up for this
violence in her life because of circumstances. She didn't have a strong family unit. She had sexual abuse growing up. She struggled with making ends meet for herself. She was at a young age of 11 years old when she was first approached by the trafficker. And at that point, she was trying to provide everything from food, water, shelter, going to school, in and out of school, not having the basic needs for her life, much less the basic emotional needs that she needed in order to thrive and survive as a young, prepubescent girl. And so when the trafficker came along, he really catalyzed on that. And for the next 7 years, Kayla will have been trafficked. She got sucked into that, coerced into that situation, and for the next 7 years, 10 to 20 men a night she was rented out to. Of course, that increased when there was events in town or different things going on that would bring a collective of men or increase the demand of people who wanted to rent her out for an hour or for a week to do whatever they wanted with her. Spending as little as $50 to abuse her. Now, if that wasn't shocking enough, what is even more shocking is that Kayla was born and raised right here in Los Angeles. She was an American-born child and was trafficked within our own county. Yes, a lot of my work started internationally, but when I started Saving Innocence, it was because I realized there are so many factors in the United States that was allowing this to thrive within our own borders and within our own cities. So what's at the basic of this? And that's really capitalism, consumeristic mentality that we have here in the US. We have a lot of money and a lot of intention to say, hey, if I can pay for it, I deserve it. If I, capitalism at its basis is to exchange money or something of value that we've decided has value, this paper, these coins that has a certain amount of value, in exchange for something that I want or think I deserve, whether that's a product, a good, or a service. And because of some of the underlying things within our society, cultural views, okay, some of these very common images, but what does it do? It has created this powerful undercurrent in modern day culture that has normalized the over-sexualization of women, and it has taught women that their sex appeal now equates their value, and it has taught men that they are objects to be used. I mean, there's so much research that's been done that has shown that even when, some of these images appear, the part of the brain that lights up in a male's mind isn't the, oh, this is a human, this is a person to build relationship. It's the, tool, I need to use this to conquer something. It's a non-human connection that highlights up in that male's brain. And it leads to this being popularized, pop culture, common culture, normalized culture, which has now generated such an environment to where the sex industry makes more money than all the sports combined. NBA, NFL, you name it, all of those combined, more money is generated now in the sex industry, which tells you how commonplace it is and how much of a high demand it is that women are of higher demand than watching a sport. So where does that leave us? Well, the Department of Justice says it's the fastest growing crime in the world. And what does that do for the United States? Well, it's a $32 billion industry, and with the United States, the lowest 10% of our poor have more resources or more money than the majority of the rest of the world. So of course that's gonna be a perfect ground for trafficking victims to be brought in. Here's just some, a map that some experts have put together that just shows some of the known trafficking routes coming into our country. But what's even talked about least is the fact that we have plenty of products here to sell. if you're thinking about this like a crime, like any other crime, which is a business, it's a monetarily driven business. The traffickers are really the end goal is to exploit people to make money. It's if it comes down to money, then they're going to try to gather the easiest products that they can. They're not going to want to import them or to deal with international laws and potential of trafficking people in and sneaking them across borders. Why do that when you have vulnerable kids that can go missing and no one cares right here within our borders, which is why, you know, out of, you know, we've worked with almost 400 children now in the last 3 years, and 70% plus were foster kids. Traffickers will say they don't just go looking for the runaways. Yes, they do that, but they're also looking for the throwaways, because the throwaways are the ones when they go missing, no one goes looking for them.
And that's the kids that we're looking for. So estimates will say that there's at least 100,000 American-born children trafficked within our borders every single year. To give perspective on that, if you think of the entire population of Pepperdine's student program, that's about 20 times that. So if we think of, if this was happening somewhere else, if our children were being trafficked into another country by criminals in Mexico, we would start a war. Like, if there was this many kids, 100,000 kids being trafficked and sold, it would be, you know, a huge uproar. So why, who are the people that are standing up to say, can you believe this is happening, like, we need to stop this? There's no outrage. The average age of the sex industry within our country is only 12 years old. So when you're thinking about pornography, prostitution, strip clubs, escort services, all the online advertising on Craigslist and Backpage and all the commonplace areas, you know, the average age is 12. The average age is 12. And law enforcement in Los Angeles specifically will say that it's 11, and it's getting younger and younger. The youngest client that we've been referred is 9. And these are babies. So what you think of, when you think of trafficking in third world countries, is absolutely happening here, and it's being hidden by our own systemic structure. It's hidden behind the culture. It's hidden behind the messaging that says, you know, going to a strip club, sexual entertainment is now become so commonplace. It's turned from like a concept of every man's battle to just like normal entertainment that businessmen just do together, that college students just experience together, that becomes a normal part of spring break entertainment. And then it's also creating the stigma associated with the kids, but because it's falling under the cultural norm and the assumption that this is a fantasy, right? The men are buying fantasy, the men are buying an experience that they are assuming is you know, whatever they're making up. And so what does that do? That sets the child up to not be recognized as a victim. It sets the child up to, because the men, you know, are paying to have an experience with someone, regardless of their age, and most of these men are situational abusers. They're not necessarily pedophiles looking for the 9-year-old, but when the 9, 10, 11-year-old comes and she looks old enough and seems like it's her free will, then he doesn't care. And we've had so many of our children that we've worked with have said, 11, 12, 13-year-old kids, that once they got into the back of someone's car, once they got into the hotel room, the buyer, we don't call them Johns because that we think is an inappropriate term for a rapist, but the buyer of that child will say, whoa, I can now see how young you are, but I already paid for you. There's this conflict. And that goes back to what's really driving this at its root, which is the consumerism. They've already paid for a service that they're now entitled to, and I've already constructed this fantasy in my head that it's your free will, and I came here to be sexually gratified, so therefore I deserve it. So it creates this perfect storm. So the reason why I wanted to touch on that is I want you to see how a lot of the normal culture really does play into all of this, and it sets the stage for this. So what I wanted to use some of these pictures to show you how commonplace it is, and to tell you just a quick story. One of our cases, just to, you know, kind of personalize it, it was a 15-year-old, a 16-year-old, and a 13-year-old. They were being trafficked all around LA. The patrol officer noticed something fishy going on. He was patrolling in North Hollywood on Blankersham Boulevard, and noticed something fishy going on at the hotel, so intervened, walked into the 13-year-old engaged in a sexual act with a 47-year-old Hispanic male. The child was handcuffed, thrown in the back of his cop car, and the 47-year-old perpetrator was handed a citation
for solicitation, which in our county, like many counties across the country, they're seen as johns. And I want to bring this and really be poignant on this for law students, because this is leading to what I want to talk about in regards to where laws can really be, when not used appropriately, harm people. And in this case, not protect the children, and to misidentify who the criminal is in this entire scenario. So right now, it is actually in our country 50 times more likely that the child is arrested, the child victim is arrested and criminalized for her victimization than the perpetrator is. In this case, the perpetrator actually was given a citation, which most don't even get that. They just walk because of the culture that feeds this is normal. It's a man's world. This is about sexual entertainment, and therefore it's the woman's fault. The process is the hooker. It's her fault. Okay, so there's all these stigmas and cultural norms that are feeding into this perfect storm. So the 13-year-old was arrested. All three of them were arrested. She ended up spending almost 9 months in jail. And this was like early on, before we had really good systems going on with intervention in LA County, which we've now helped develop. But this was the early days where law enforcement actually had to sneak me, and they were like, just dress up in a suit and act like you're a lawyer. And they snuck me into the back of the juvenile hall so I could talk to this girl. And that sort of like started saving innocence. So it was like that level of grassroots, like just trying whatever I could to get to the victims, to help them, to let them know they had support, and to create that support system around them. But unfortunately in this scenario, you know, what happens to most is the buyer was given the citation, which meant that he had to appear in a John school. Has anyone heard of these John schools? So a John school is as much of a joke as traffic school. You show up for a few hours, no one pays attention. You know, you see videos of these, and it's like their question and answer is like, yo, when can I get the next hooker? Like literally, like it's like that much of a joke. The guys are so disrespectful. It's like they're so counterproductive. But the point is, you know, that these buyers are being treated with misdemeanor, going to this traffic school for Johns, and then at the end of it, once they finish this five-hour program, they pay a small fine of a few hundred dollars. That's about $9,500 less than if you were to get a DUI. Okay, this is the value that we're putting on her life, right? And when he completes the class, his record is completely cleared, as if nothing happened, and his privacy is protected. His family isn't notified that he's been soliciting for sex, which of course puts them at medical risk, right? The child isn't advocated for. He's protected, okay? So huge gap in our legal system to be redirecting these crimes to be under the appropriate categories rather than under solicitation. That we should be seeing this as child rape, and just because there's an exchange of money, which in my opinion should make it worse, if he's premeditated and willing to pay to abuse a child, in my mind, that should be a harsher penalty. But definitely not treated as he is right now, because that is absolutely keeping the criminals on the streets and creating a safety risk for all of us. So California Penal Code prohibits the engaging in the act of prostitution or offering or soliciting the act of prostitution, which could be applied to, quote, the prostitute or the, quote, John. But when it comes to teens, this should not be a possibility, because there is also federal law, the Trafficking Persons Act, Victim and Protection Act, that was originated in the year 2000, been reacted multiple times since, that states very clearly that under federal law, human trafficking law, the main contingencies are force, fraud, and coercion. If someone's been forced into something, there's been fraudulent, offers, and then kind of a bait and switch scenario, they're not paid, they're abused, they're being held against their will, right? When it's sex trafficking, so when it's an exchange of money for a sexual act of any kind, and that could be pornography, by the way, like anything that's of sexual nature, then there's not a burden of proof when they're under the age of 18, because we have other laws in place like statutory rape laws, and professional psychologists up to this point for years and years in our country that have determined that if a 13-year-old is having sex with a 50-year-old, the 50-year-old should be held accountable and responsible as an adult, and that shouldn't be held, the child should not have, they're not old enough, they haven't come to the developmental part of their minds and their processes of growing up to make those decisions. That it's the adult's responsibility, and it's an obvious exploitative situation due to age and probably a number of other things, right? Statutory rape laws exist in our country for good reason. So why is it when there's an exchange of money that those go out the window? Why is it when she's forced into it and there's traffickers beating her, raping her, torturing her? And I mean torture. I mean, some of them are more coercive, and it's, you know, what law enforcement will say is the chain around the brain. It's the total manipulation. It's like cultic. But some of it is like girls being locked in cages and trunks of cars and being tortured, like scars for life type of stuff. And yet, she's the one criminalized for that victimization. I mean, this is so many layers deep that we need to dissect and begin to change in our country. I don't know if many of you have seen this breaking story. I'm not gonna go into it for the sake of time, but you know, this is a young girl, she's 15, and it's all over the news right now because there's a lot of advocacy groups raising up. But in Grand Rapids, Michigan, this is a 15-year-old, obviously too young to consent to sex, obvious under federal law, victim of child trafficking, and I'm only showing her face because it's literally on everyone's Facebook. I mean, it's, and even there's a change.org campaign right now, which I'm actually would love as like an action step after this, to not just go to Saving Innocence's website, but to go to the Facebook page where this is posted so you guys can all sign the petition. But basically, a 15-year-old was used as bait. She had three traffickers behind her. And was posted on Backpage and Craigslist, and what was happening was when these men would come to have sex with her in these hotel rooms, they were being then, I don't know, kidnapping is the right word, but like the traffickers were using a toy gun to then bring them to a ATM to steal from them, right? Out of all these people involved in this scenario, the buyers coming to have sex with a child, the three traffickers who are enslaving this child, forcing her, posting her naked child pornography pictures online to use her as bait for these men, and she's the one arrested. It's like the most crazy making case because you know who was the victim in those courtrooms. The buyers. Right? This entire case was built around the fact that the buyers who were trying to purchase a child sat in court as free men and as the victims in this case, and she got sentenced to up to 20 years in prison. Okay, it's just a perfect angering example of how far we are in a lot of these things and how critical it is for laws to change and to develop so that the victims are protected. I know I'm out of time. So I'll just jump to one quote. If there's a question of, so why doesn't she leave? Why didn't she just run? You know, I mean, I talked about the chain around the brain, I talked about the torture, but just to highlight for you, this is actually, you know, do not buy this book because we don't promote supporting traffickers, but there is an actual trafficker or pimp that wrote a book, and there's other versions of this, you know, around, but this one's shockingly sold on Target.com and Amazon. And it's called Pimpology, the 48 Rules of the Game, and it's basically teaching young players how to be traffickers. Which again shows culture, upbringing, there's so many factors involved with this, but it's pretty poignant how manipulative and this is. You'll start to dress her, think for her, own her. If you and your victim are sexually active, slow it down. After sex, take her shopping for one item. Hair and her nails is fine. She'll develop a feeling of accomplishment. The shopping after a month will be replaced with cash. The lovemaking turns into raw sex. She'll start to crave the intimacy and be willing to get back into your good graces. After you've broken her spirit, she has no sense of self-value. Now, pimp, put a price tag on the item you have manufactured. So, the laws need a shift to be protecting our children,
to be protecting the most vulnerable in our society. I'm going to just skip to the end. Here's some of, you know, the work that we've been doing. We've been able to establish FIRST protocol in LA County. It's the first of a kind in the nation that's strategically collaborative. So Saving Innocence is the only nonprofit that's actually contracted by Los Angeles County, along with government agencies like LA Sheriff, LAPD, Long Beach PD, Department of Child and Family Services, and Probation Department. And now what is happening is we're able to create a mandate to where when the children are discovered that they are no longer treated like a criminal, that they're identified as a child victim, as a child, that should be the key word there. There's no such thing as a child prostitute. Those words should never go together. It suggests choice, and that's not a possibility in these scenarios. And so now that we've been able to train over 4,000 law enforcement. We do vice trainings every single year in this county and up and down the state. I'm on the state task force as a founding member to really decipher how to do best care aftercare, as well as create policy around this issue. But since we've been able to be strategically collaborative, and law enforcement is now mandated in our county to call the Child Protective Hotline, treat the child as a victim, and then dispatch us, we respond within 90 minutes, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week to these children, bringing them freedom bags and then walking them through long-term crisis case management and care, often for years to come. And with this collaboration, zero kids have been identified falsely as a criminal. 20% had come from other states and were relocated successfully. Zero have returned to their trafficker. Before, a large percentage were, because they really didn't believe they had a way out. Now they have a support system and they aren't too afraid to stay away. Everyone was connected to a support team. We've been in partnership with law enforcement to help in the arrest of over 50 traffickers, and we have 100% conviction rate with every case that we're involved with, because the kids have safety and support in order to testify, and a lot of these cases are really contingent on those testimonies. Okay, in conclusion, just want to show you a couple pictures of Kayla. This is Kayla now. Our kids, absolutely, when empowered, have the ability to live healthy, thriving lives. She just turned 21, and as we're working towards laws that actually create healthy guidelines for our society and to protect the true victims, we are able to empower the most vulnerable to thrive, and that in turn creates safety for us all. Nelson Mandela, you know, said that our society can be defined by how we treat its weakest members. And so more than any other issue, these are our weakest members in our society. They are not only they're not only children, but they're the most vulnerable children without anyone. There are foster kids, there are orphans. So I just encourage you and invite you to stand with us and help us save innocence. Thank you.
I want to give you an opportunity to interact with Kim, if you don't mind staying up here.
Oh, okay.
What questions do you have for Kim? This is an awesome opportunity for you to pick her brain and her heart on the things that she's doing and the things that you're interested in.
Any of the victims male?
Yeah. I don't think nationwide we have like a really great set on that. Out of the hundreds that we've worked with, we've had six. My personal theory is that just like if you think back to the beginning of the sexual assault movement, when we were having conversations like, it's not her fault because she wore a crop top, and no, she didn't consent to sex just because her jeans were too tight. You know, I'm sure you're familiar with the court case not too long ago where, you know, the why we have denim day. Has anyone heard of the denim day? We now celebrate once a year, which basically signifies the court case that had said that it was the woman obviously consented to sex when she was raped because her jeans were so tight she must have helped him get them off. Okay, so that's denim day. So like in the beginning of that movement, we were having to prove a woman's right to her own body, and to, you know, that sexual assault happens and it's something that we need to do something about. Same with domestic violence. It's this, and you know, it follows that same line to where we're now first proving, hey, these kids are victims. Like, someone needs to be a voice for them. It's not their fault. They shouldn't be held responsible just because they were a child in the wrong place at the wrong time.
and she's a child. But just like with the sexual assault movement, how much harder was it for male victims to come forward when they were sexually assaulted? There's so much more stigma involved, so many complicated factors with like proof of consent, and you know, there's a lot. It's messy. It's trickier with boys and young men, and so likewise with this, the majority of the boys that we're seeing are more like the LGBT community, transgender, that are homeless, survival sex related, then trafficked and forced.
So right now, what can you
do? I really would love you guys to go to Saving Innocence's Facebook page, or even like our Twitter feed or whatever media channels you prefer, and go to the change.org thing. That's kind of like an immediate, hey, this is a real kid that really needs our help right now. It's just like something we could all do. Easy, just type the little button and you know, make a signature. We need tons of help. I mean, on here, I really am inviting people to become partners and become monthly donors. That's really how we do what we do. We're dependent on partners who can't be always on the front lines with us to be on the front lines with us and make what we do possible. That partnership is integral to these kids' lives, and it costs about $3,000 a year to provide services for that child for that year, which, you know, there's more information online. In addition to that, as you know, hopefully you learned something new today, and you all, especially in today's day and age, have very powerful voices to spread that on, to be having interesting conversations, especially with the men in the room, the guys in the room. I challenge you to have some of these conversations with your guy friends, and challenge them on some of the issues that are surrounding, you know, the trafficking of children is the ugliest fruit of a very sick tree, and we need to be talking about all the different roots and factors that are feeding this. If we're really going to end this in our country. Yeah?
You talked earlier about the John School. So has there been anything done to kind of revamp that and actually provide education to these men and kind of re-teach them that it's not the consumer type of thing, but that what they did was actually a more serious crime?
Yeah, they don't care. Typically, I mean, the research that has been done has shown that the things that will actually deter them is when you go after their pocketbooks or their public figure state, which is why Supervisor Kanabi this last year, you know, was trying to launch like the shame campaign, which would be like making it public who these men are that are buying these girls or kids. And there's also a lot of legislation coming down to increase their penalties and fines. I still don't support any of it because it's still keeping it. It's like, okay, let's charge them $1,500. Like, are you crazy? Like, we're like looking at this under the wrong umbrella. If you're like, if you understand the law, you understand that this isn't its wrong category in general. Like, don't just try to like fluff it up in its inappropriate category. We need to understand, you know, and there's the argument of, well, what if these guys don't know that she's a child? I don't care. And here's why. Because under federal law, if there's child pornography, if a man is looking at child pornography and he doesn't know it's a child, under federal law, he will still 100% of the time be convicted for child pornography, which, by the way, under federal law is a minimum of 10 years. So if someone is looking at a child online somewhere, and even if he doesn't know that she is 15, and can be sentenced to 10 years minimum, what are we doing with someone who is in person raping a child? I don't care if he didn't know she was, you know, she said she was 19. Just how about not buy people? Like, that can make your life like a safer, you know, if you want to avoid getting penalized for this, then how about you just, you know, find another form of entertainment that doesn't exploit others. So I think the conversation's starting, but I still don't think that we're moving in the right direction. Yeah.
Statutory rape is strict liability, right? I mean, you're immediately guilty. So how are these guys getting away with this?
Because it's like a loophole in the law. It's because they're being
prosecuted under solicitation, period. And you ask, how? I mean, in the beginning of the years, I was you. I was like, how? Why? How? Like, this doesn't make any logical sense to me. But it's happening 100% of the time across the U.S. 50 times to one, he's never arrested. She is. He's never even held accountable at all. And when he is, there's not been one case. There's not been one case of him being actually convicted for human trafficking or, in our county, child rape. He's termed a John. Because there's an exchange of money. It makes no sense. We need to reframe it, put it under the appropriate law, which is the statutory rape. I mean, our laws exist. There's a lot of push for, you know, getting new laws in the books, which I agree with. There needs to be, like, some additions under the trafficking laws and whatnot. But if we understood this better as a culture and stopped, like, accepting this as a man's entertainment in general and understood what was the realities of the sex industry and the realities of who's involved and what's really going on, the dark truth, then we would be putting him in a different category. But so many people in our culture have already bought into it harming no one, you know. Porn harms no one. Buying this person who's consensual harms no one. No, it's actually false. Yeah.
One more.
Sorry.
So is the lack of prosecution in these cases, would you attribute that more to law enforcement or the judicial system, or how do we actively try and change the way that people are looking at this?
It's a good question. You know, I mean, if you look at the breaking news case that I, you know, pointed out in Grand Rapids, that was law enforcement that built the case incorrectly. That was district attorneys that didn't recognize her as a victim and treated her as such. And it was a jury of general public people that decided that she needed to go into prison for 20 years, and a judge who, when they tried to decrease her bail, just so that she could see her one-year-old twins before she went to jail, and they said no. The judge said no. So it's like, on every level of injustice in this case is crazy. But that's what that is common. You know, we now in our county, you know, we've made a lot of groundwork. In the early years, I almost got thrown out of court multiple times. Like, I'm kind of infamous in the law enforcement, because once we had law enforcement friends, they were building the cases properly, and then you'd have just this, like, crazy judge or crazy DA that was, like, calling my 13-year-old a whore on stage and threatening to throw her in jail. And I'm like, what is happening? Like, am I crazy? Because I feel like I'm crazy right now that no one's seen this. So it really is on every level. We've made a lot of progress because now we've had contracts, Saving Instance has, with the DA's office and all the law enforcement, you know. But there's still, I mean, in all those government agencies, there's turnover every 2 to 3 years. So it's like new people to train and to educate and to help build cases with. And it's ongoing. Yeah, thank you.
So a question,
yeah.
For you, given the clientele in this room of people who want to get busy,
yeah.
Do you take interns? Do you train volunteers? If they wanted to get involved on the ground with Saving Innocence, for example, is it feasible? Are there opportunities?
It is, yeah. And I know our director of clinical service, her name's Amber Davies. She's a licensed clinical social worker. She oversees all of our clinical services. And she's been in discussions with Pepperdine Law about forming a more strategic partnership. I'm not sure exactly what those conversations are right now, but you can email, probably best would be to email, you can email me, kim@savinginstance.org, or if you want to specifically figure out how Pepperdine is building a relationship with Saving Innocence, probably email Amber, which is just amber@savinginnocence.org. Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Thank you,
Kim.
Thank you. Our next speaker is Shannon Cedric Davis. She's the CEO of Bridgeway Foundation. Shannon has this amazing passion for social justice and international human rights, speaks about these things all over the world, but more importantly, has been engaged in major strategic efforts with real results in her work and in the work that Bridgeway is doing now. She began many years ago. We met 10 years ago when she was with IJM as their public affairs director, and she's been doing more and more amazing work since that time. She's here to visit with us today. We're gonna do a little bit of a question and answer. I'm gonna tee up a few questions and let Shannon talk, and then we'll have an opportunity for you guys to engage as well. So would you please welcome Shannon Cedric. Maybe we should should sit so that the microphones catch it on the video. Do you want to greet everybody and make a couple of opening comments before I hit you with your first question?
Yes. No, I'm so excited to be with all of you guys today. I have a little bit of law school envy. I went to law school at Baylor in Texas. And you guys have better scenery than we did in Waco. So thanks for having me with you guys.
Maybe just generally tell us a little bit about what Bridgeway is about, and then we'll get into some specifics.
Great, yeah. So our foundation exists to be a catalyst in terms of hope and reconciliation, but largely our core mission is to stop mass atrocity and genocide in the world. So you can imagine the mandate is quite a daunting one. We have a money management and mutual funds company that has about $6 billion under management, and half of those profits generated from that company are what fuel the foundation and its work.
Wonderful. All right, we're going to dig in for time's sake. Tell us who is the LRA, and what are some of the non-traditional approaches you've taken to address them?
And we might even be able to skip this question. Who in here is familiar with the LRA? That's great. Okay. Good, good. I figured that this would be an audience that would be quite educated on the subject. The LRA is Africa's longest running conflict or war, almost up to 30 years now. You guys, if you aren't familiar with the LRA, are probably familiar with the name of its leader, Joseph Kony, who was notorious for kidnapping children and brutally murdering civilians in northern Uganda. And then now it has spread across three different countries, Central African Republic, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and even South Sudan.
In your work dealing with these people, what steps have you had to take to ensure that you're doing justice without doing harm?
Yeah, and so this is something we could talk about for quite a while, and I know our time here is short. We looked at what was going on with the LRA, and in particular paid attention to the 2008 Christmas massacres. We funded Invisible Children. Adam Fink with my company, he's been with me for a couple of years. He is formerly with Invisible Children, and we partnered with them in very early days before they received a lot of traction and funded their first ever film as a foundation. So that was the way that we learned about the LRA. And then as we started to watch the brutality and what was going on in particular there, we really had a crisis of conscience, right? Our mission statement said that we strived for a world without genocide, and it never felt like we were truly striving for that. It felt like we were putting band-aids on bullet holes, right, for lack of a better word, that we would go in after the damage was done and rebuild the school that was burned down. Or a well would be poisoned and we'd go in and drill another well. But it never felt like we were actually doing anything to stop the actual conflict. And so we got to this place where there was somewhat of a crisis of conscience and just asked ourselves, do we want to change our mission statement? Or do we want to try to mean what we say? And do we want to see if we can do something to stop a conflict on the globe? We took a really big step back. At that point, we had probably donated in almost 80 different countries and had given a couple hundred grants a year, and really looked at all of those conflicts and thought, well, what is, if we're going to try to do this, what would be the most sort of low-hanging fruit, if you will? And at the time, at least, it hasn't really turned out to be the case, but at the time, at least, we thought the LRA would give us our best shot at piloting, trying to help make a difference in stopping a war. Then we started to do some pretty unconventional stuff for intervening. We initially, we were finding that, especially during the 2009 Christmas massacre, you had that occur about 20 kilometers from a United Nations base that had peacekeepers forward deployed to protect these people. The peacekeepers did not leave their compound during that time. It happened over a multi-day period. And you had a village slaughtered, and then the LRA would move and slaughter another village and move and slaughter another village. And so we asked ourselves, is there some basic things that could occur that would allow civilians to protect and warn each other. And so we launched the early starts of something called the early warning system. You'll see there on that bamboo pole, that is a radio tower, and it allowed elders from villages to reach out to other villages and warn them of impending attacks, which would at least give the civilians an early chance to flee. Adam himself would go find radios for us in far-flung capitals within Central and East Africa and come back and meet with these folks and help make this happen. As a result of this, we were starting to actually gain information, right? So when you have people reporting attacks, then you start to actually see trends in what's going on. And in order to be good stewards of those trends, we helped start a website that still exists today, at the LRA Crisis Tracker. And you can actually see publicly on the website what attacks might be occurring and when, and look at those trends. Felt like there was some accountability in publishing that information for the UN and some of the others that were forward deployed to protect these individuals. But then we found that that was not closing the gap sufficiently, and we really felt like there was a lack of will on behalf of the UN to be proactive to try to stop this. At the same time, there were some African Union forces that were deployed, primarily Ugandan, almost entirely Ugandan in the beginning, and when we finished, still about 95% Ugandan. And they were deployed to stop the LRA. And what we were hearing about them in terms of their inability to do any true damage to try to actually dismantle this rebel group was that they lacked any basic training. So we hired a private military company to train an African army to try to specifically stop the LRA. And yes, every time I say that, I know that I sound crazy. Still to this day, it does not sound normal to me. And given that we have such few amounts of time, I'll just try to quickly go through with that. But they were trained in many tactics, but specifically in terms of pseudo-operation and how to look for particular rebel groups. They were taught to swim. So a huge challenge was that the LRA could evade these troops that were pursuing them because the troops would stop at the rivers. They wouldn't be able to swim across the rivers and actually be able to continue pursuit in a lot of cases, so they learned how to swim. We met with the head of Human Rights Watch and some other organizations ahead of time because we knew we were entering some very tricky space in terms of the do no harm line, and they really encouraged us to look at cultural training and human rights training for the group that we were in particular training. We also were very picky about those that we selected. They were fairly young troops that were trained and did a vetting process to make sure that there weren't human rights abuses on anyone's record who in particular were trained. They were also taught how to track others and to look at intelligence in a way that that really could amplify their particular missions. They even took time to train me. Now that's not for real. This is me before I did that day, and I am praying. So for those of you in the room who pray, that was my biggest prayer, was for safety. I was scared to death in doing that, but felt like the training was important too. So after that, we deployed these troops. We found that they were actually able to be quite successful, and we started to see a rapid decrease in terms of incidents of attack because someone was actually pursuing the guys who were making these decisions and who were committing these crimes. And as a result, it allowed us to look at some other gaps. We initiated work with a canine hostage rescue team, so we deployed some dogs and were able to train some of the African Union troops on how to use the dogs to especially find children who, after being kidnapped, might be sloughed off because they couldn't keep pace with the rebel groups that they had been kidnapped by. Also to be able to pick up on scent articles and help find certain individuals that might have been tracked. The terrain out there is quite vast and very thick, and so it was often difficult to pursue these groups, and the canine dogs really help you just be able to cut straight to the source. In particular, the canine group helped us be able to launch an operation against the number 3 indictee of the International Criminal Court, now almost 2 years ago, and that mission was successful. We also did flyer drops, and this is my favorite part of the work that we did. We were able to launch a defection campaign because, mind you, a lot of these actual troops were kidnapped, right, when they were kids. So whether the LRA went into a school when these boys were 8, 10, 12 years old, kidnapped them, now 20 years later, they're legitimate fighters themselves. And Ugandan law was set up in a way that was very helpful to defections. They set up a law that allowed amnesty for anyone who would walk out of their own will other than one of the three International Criminal Court indictees. And as a result of that, we were really able to leverage messaging campaigns. And so if we could get the word out to these commanders that they could come home and could come home safely, it would still be a big risk for them, but they might be able to walk out. That included the flyer drops, and we dropped over 700,000 flyers in our time out in the field over the last several years. We also did these loudspeaker messages, which was really fun because they could double for dance parties in the evenings out in the jungle if you got bored, and bolted these big speakers onto the helicopters. And pretty fascinating what you can do nowadays with technology. So let's say one of the commanders that we wanted to target for defection because they were causing a lot of trouble, Adam or Laren or one of my colleagues could actually fly back to his hometown in Gulu and find his mother if she happened to still be alive, or maybe one of his sisters, and use his iPhone to record a personal message from them encouraging them to defect, and then could plug those into the speakers, and we could hover the helicopter over a general geography of where we felt like they were. Again, triple canopy jungle, so you had to be very targeted in terms of those messages. But lots of creativity around just using, honestly, simple resources and our iPhones and being able to accomplish quite a bit. Another area where that was extremely helpful is some of the men who took early risk to walk out and assumed that they would be safe. A lot of times you'd find that Joseph Kony and other commanders would lie and say, oh no, they're being killed once they've walked out. So we'd be able to put several of them actually on the helicopter, and they would use the speaker to talk to their colleagues and to some of the other rebel fighters that they'd worked with over the years and say, no, I am free, I'm back in Uganda, this is what it looks like, and that really helped further bolster our abilities there. We saw this lead to 703 defections over the five-year period that we worked on this project. And in particular, one defection, this gentleman, Opio Sam, who was kidnapped and in the LRA for decades, kidnapped as a child. When he defected, he brought 43 with him. So that was a pretty fantastic day. We had children as young as 1 week old. We had a baby actually that was born and then evacuated shortly after her birth. In terms of some of our defections, her mom, his mom later subsequently died. But no, pretty remarkable in terms of having an opportunity to really help some people walk free. Something that really is the anchor for that, though, is there has to be a place for these people to plug back in, and I'm sure that's something you guys are thinking in your minds, especially given some of the absolute catastrophe that they may have caused for their own communities, and certainly, if not for their own communities, and other communities. And so that's, honestly, that's the hardest part of this work. We've gone back and forth about how involved and engaged we want to be in that part, because the aftercare part is heavy. It's heavy from a work perspective. It's a long-term game. It's also extremely expensive. But we've really been able to, because there is a relatively small number of LRA and these commanders, been able to help each one of them get resettled if they're willing. That starts with an early resettlement package that doesn't make a huge investment in them until we're sure that they're really willing to also invest in themselves. In particular, Opio Sam now has got his mechanics degree, and he's starting a mechanic shop in his hometown, which is really exciting. And several others that we have very similar success stories about. So you'll find that as they go back into these communities, it's sort of difficult to talk about from a justice perspective, because my American justice mind doesn't understand the grace that is afforded to these these gentlemen and these men going back into these communities. But it is one, and it's significant. Adam has been present at several community meetings where they'll bring back one of these men who, again, maybe was kidnapped at 8 years old and now, you know, almost 30 years later is returning to his community. And they do a ceremony. They actually usually have an egg that is broken, and when the egg is broken, it's symbolic of forgiveness and choosing to move forward. And it's remarkable the grace these communities extend. I often ask these folks about that in particular. How are you able to forgive? And is, you know, you want to look behind the cover and see if it's real. You know, are you really forgiving, or is this? And the responses are always some deviation of, if we don't choose peace, we choose to stay in this place, and we choose to stay in war. And I just think personally, I can't understand that, because I've fortunately lived in a time here in America where I didn't face that decision. But it's been a powerful lesson to us for sure.
Can I break with our script for just a second? With this group and who we have in the room that have really hearts like yours and a desire to make a difference, and you've been doing this for a while, you're a strategist, you've learned a lot, and we're here around this idea of what have we learned about how we can actually make this really solid justice movement happen where atrocities are happening without creating harm. Yeah. Share with us your heart a little bit about what you've learned, what you see, and how you're moving forward in being really strategic about making a difference without creating problems, and how hard that is in the kinds of situations you find yourself. Is that an okay question?
It's such an okay question, and is it okay if I'm just really candid with you guys? Because we certainly have not figured that out. I will tell you that was the hardest part of this for me. This was a real moral question for me. So we're from Texas, but I don't even let my children play with water guns, right? And here I'm actually hiring a private military company to train an African army. The disconnect is, it's impossible for me to convey to you. I wish I could let you just peer inside my heart and see the disconnect in terms of that for me from a moral compass perspective. And we had been present for such an extended period of time with these people and had gotten to know people who then later were being preyed upon. And all signs were leading to this intervention being necessary. We tried almost everything else first. So I begged the United States State Department to take our money and to do the training, because it makes just a lot more sense. They would know who to call. You know, there's not in the yellow pages, you can't just look up like private military trainers. It's not there. So I mean, we really didn't even know where to start. So we did spend a series of months with them back and forth and with their general counsel in hopes that they would actually just allow us to grant money to them and for them to be the providers of the training, potentially through the State Department in Uganda. We spent quite a bit of time going back and forth and almost creating somewhat of an accountability system, because you see what's dangerous about what we've done and the questions that should be asked that for some reason we still feel like we're not getting asked very much is, who am I accountable to as a private citizen, right? U.S. governments, foreign militaries, they're all accountable to somebody. Truthfully, I don't have to be accountable to anybody. In this particular case, we chose to set up an accountability group that included some incredible greats. I sit on a board called the Elders that Archbishop Desmond Tutu chairs, and Arch was a great advisor during that time to me. Ken Roth with Human Rights Watch. I mean, literally, I looked around and I said, who would have the biggest problem with what we're about to do? And those are the people we need to talk to before we do it. And again, we found in doing so that this seemed to make sense in this one instance, but I very much scare myself in terms of not wanting to set a precedent about this type of intervention. Intervention cannot be one size fits all in terms of justice and in terms of conflicts. And all of these conflicts are so incredibly unique, and the geographies are so unique. And a lot could have gone wrong. I mean, I feel oftentimes that it was very miraculous in how things unfolded, and that things didn't go wrong the way they could have. And so I think that it's extremely important that that while there aren't the kind of rules that you would assume there are, so we did get all the proper legal paperwork ahead of time, and we continued to find out that there actually weren't any rules that would prohibit me from doing this, which is mind-blowing. I mean, I think you, as a lawyer myself, I thought there has to be a rule we're going to bump up against eventually. There has to be a law. But there just wasn't as we went. And so I think that for me, my greatest concern would be two things. The first being, there aren't those rules, and we put arbitrary, in my opinion, arbitrary fences around how we believe that we can intervene on another's behalf. And that's a tragic shame, and people are dying, and the situation is dire overseas. And so I just want to say, like, we don't have that excuse anymore, and what unfolded with us is evidence that that excuse does not exist. But secondly, I would say that we need to be really cautious as we think about how we go about this. And I wouldn't recommend considering something like this unless you are able to be fully present with the communities in which you're hoping to serve. Because oftentimes you'll see that they actually have all the solutions. They just sometimes lack a few resources and an ability to truly be present and fully present with those who you are there to serve is the key, I think, to unlocking enormous potential and solutions. We just had a big third-party review. We hired a ex-former head of the clandestine services for the United States and some military guys to actually do a formal review of our intervention. We really wanted to look at it and look at it in a very clear way. And my favorite quote, they interviewed so many people that we were involved with, but they also interviewed the head of the African Union forces that we walked alongside during this process. And my favorite quote from him was, when we ate the bitter root, they ate the bitter root. And that quote, that was the value he felt like we brought, was sort of, if you'll allow me, the gift of our presence, right? Actually just being there and being present. There was rarely a time that Adam or Laren or myself weren't deployed and in the field at the same time. And I do think that that allows you permission to think about creative solutions and try to hedge around this do no harm, if you will. Because when we go in with our white faces and we think we've got it all figured out, I think we can run into even substantially more problems. So,
so good, thank you. I could sit for a week and ask you questions. And I've got a whole bunch more if you guys don't have any, but I thought I'd open it up. And if you have some questions, you can see what an amazing moment we have here to sit with Shannon and understand the things that she could help us in terms of our futures and the things that you guys are thinking about wanting to do in the world. Annika.
So first, just thank you for your heart and all of your hearts for the fact that they do beat fast for justice and for these issues. And back when I was going to law school, we didn't have a single class that we could find to take that even touched any of this. And so things have changed and changed in a dramatic fashion. I almost feel like the field has become somewhat competitive, which is mind-blowing to me because literally no one else but me and the entire three classes at my law school wanted to do this work. So just commend you guys for being willing to put your hearts out there and get in the game. A couple of pieces of advice. First piece would be a door kicker. Even if you are shy and quiet and reserved, go kick down opportunities for yourselves, whatever it takes, right? Even if you have to raise funds and resources somewhere else and go offer yourself for free to an organization or two that's doing the kind of work that you care about, go and do it. Be present. That's going to build up your resume. It's going to show, it's going to actually show those of us that are on the other end of receiving the resumes that not only do you think you have a passion for this, but you've gone and tested that passion by being present and doing work in that field. So I think that's actually literally more important than what your standing is in your class, more important than where you went to school, is going to be actually putting your boots on the ground and being able to show that it's something that you truly are passionate about. And just constantly think about how you're going to make that compelling case for what it is that you want to do. I'd also say that we don't have very good ideas still in the world. Like, there's this huge void of ideas in terms of intervention and how we can start to move humanity forwards instead of backwards. And so for those of you who have ideas, I'd say absolutely finding ways to get those piloted, even in very small settings, and start to learn from them will be very powerful, because I think there's going to be a whole generation of philanthropists that are looking to you guys to have the answers.
So from your experience, the field is not saturated. There's still room for pioneers around the world.
No, not at all. I think that what is saturated probably is in terms of, I also was formerly with a shoe company called Tom's, where I sat on their board, and I remember they would get like 10,000 applications for 100 intern jobs, right? That sounds and feels saturated. But in terms of innovation in this space, not at all. And in terms of conflict and mass atrocity work in particular, if that is something that's of interest, genocide, I mean, some of these super hard issues in that regard, I feel like there's still a lot of room. But it may not be through the traditional organizations that you find your opportunities. Absolutely. And that was the same case with me. So my mom and dad joke that when I was really young, I would bring home stray animals. And then by the time I got to high school, I would bring home the stray kids who'd been kicked out of their house, you know, and then I sort of graduated to going to Turkey to do work there. And so, I mean, I think exactly, we probably have unique hearts and souls in this room, right? And they beat fast for justice and they're compassionate, and getting our hands around what that means we're specifically created in all the world to do and be can be complex, but I think it honestly starts with just getting some experience and getting out there, and it's going to help you filter that. The best example I can give is during law school, the earthquakes, the major earthquakes in Turkey happened in Adabazar and Golcik. And over a spring break, there was an opportunity to go and do some earthquake relief. I went and did some relief. And then I actually went back to do further relief because I met some folks on the ground who needed more help through the organization. And when I was there, I would have to ride the escalator across the Bosphorus every day to go from the European side to the Asian side and back. And at those landings for the ferry, there was a boy that was peddling these little Kleenex boxes. His name's Pilar. And he was a street child. And I realized and learned by asking a lot of questions about the plight of a street child. And then I realized, oh, I was so much more passionate about the street children and the justice issues surrounding that than I was about the quake relief that I had gone to do. And so again, just there's this sharpening, if you will, of your heart, I think, as you think about this. And a lot of journaling that I went back and reflected on in terms of things I had learned and inputs that came along the way. I spent a lot of time doing human trafficking work. That was my early work with International Justice Mission. I feel like I still do human trafficking work. These kids up here, child soldiers, and they're absolutely trafficked. So I think, yeah, I think it's real interesting. And then being willing to, if you find that you're somewhere and it is not a right fit, also being willing to recognize that. I think sometimes that's the hardest thing. I think saying yes is sometimes easier than saying no. And the earlier you can figure that out, the better. I'm terrible at saying no. So, I think that could be helpful as well.
So, I'm sorry, I know the hands would start to fly up if we could keep going. Shannon had some really urgent things come up this morning and hung in there with us, for which we're so grateful for, but we have to actually get her whisked off to LAX and on a plane and back home. I understand Kim's gonna run her to the airport, so we need to let them scoot out. So what we're gonna do is just take a 1 minute stand and stretch break while we let them gather their things and we switch our technology, and then we'll kick in with Jim Black here in a minute. But let's thank these wonderful leaders. Thank you. Thank you so much.